Hello guys, welcome back to GKCodelabs. So today is the first session of my Apache Spark series. As I told in my previous video that in this sessions we will be following the official documentation of Apache Spark. So here is my first video. Let's start with introduction to Spark and its documentation. In this session we will have a small discussion of what actually Spark is, how its document looks like, and how to actually access the documentation properly to get the most out of it. So without any further ado, let's jump on to Apache Spark's official documentation. So let me Google it, as most of us do. Apache Spark documentation. I'll increase the font a little bit so that it's visible to you. So the first link you can see, documentation, Apache Spark. Okay, let's go to the main page itself. Okay, so this is something what our official documentation looks like. So let's quickly browse it first. Apache Spark, lightning fast unified analytics engine. So taking one step back, let me also very quickly tell what is Apache Spark for those who are not really aware as of now what is Spark and want to learn and want to relate some of their big data knowledge to what Spark is. As per definition, Spark is actually, let me mention here, it is a cluster computing framework, as per definition, a small definition. Now very quickly, what is cluster computing framework? Let's break it down. What is a computing framework? In big data, if you have a huge amount of data and you have to compute it, as simple as that, you have to compute some data, and any framework used for computing that data is a computing framework. Now in addition to that, it is a cluster computing framework. So have a small image in your mind, like suppose this is a computer which we are using to process our data. Let's say it has a certain amount of CPU, certain amount of RAM and graphics processor or anything. So if we have to process a data on a computer, the processing speed of the data, the amount of data, the time taken by this computer to process a certain amount of data will depend upon this machine's resources, like CPU. If the process algorithm is graphics intensive, then it matters on the graphics processor of this machine, and all the memory computation depends on the size of memory of this machine. But as here we have to process a big amount of data, we do not go with this approach. We take multiple similar computers. Okay? They can be 5, 10, 1000, 10,000, any number of computers. And whatever data we process with the help of additional resources, the power of CPU of each, power of memory, graphics of each machine in addition, we use all the resources of these computers parallelly, and such kind of combined efforts is known as cluster computing. Now coming to what is Spark? Spark is a framework which enables you to write some code so as to what operations you have to do on your data. You have to calculate, aggregate, or whatever operation you have to do on your data. It enables you to code that, and when you run that code on the backend, it has the feature of executing that code which will process your data on this entire cluster. So it is Spark that enables you to process a particular logic or algorithm on the data that is distributed on different machines and very well manage the flow of data among the machines, consolidating that distributed data for any further use, and all the operations that has to be collectively done on your data, but which is otherwise very difficult if you don't use Spark, because your data is distributed. For example, let's suppose you have a big file. You have a 100 GB file and that data is distributed among your cluster. Let's suppose some 10 GB is here, 10 GB is here, and other also distributed among 5 or 10 nodes. Now you have to take that file and let's suppose it has some numbers and you have to sort all the numbers in that file. But do you think if you sort this particular node data, is your requirement fulfilled? No, because you had 100 GB which is distributed on other nodes also. But the sorted output will have entire 100 GB. So all that playing with the data from one node to other, this is just a small example. So all that data that has to be played from one node to other in case of sorting, searching, that all calculations will be taken care by Spark. So I hope now this definition of cluster computing framework is clear to you, and that is what Spark is. Let's move on. So now we have a background what Spark is actually. Let's go through the documentation menu. First menu is downloads. So here Spark gives option to download different stable releases, different type of packages like pre-built for Hadoop, without Hadoop, the source code. Okay, then let's very briefly discuss this second point also. What are these different things? Now, what was pre-built for Hadoop, source code and all? So Spark basically can be run without Hadoop also. Hadoop is not essential for Spark. So let's say you have a Hadoop cluster which you have, where you have all your data. You can run Spark on this Hadoop cluster itself using YARN, or if you do not have a Hadoop cluster, you can run YARN on standalone mode also. It does not require Hadoop cluster. So that is what documentation says. Pre-built for Hadoop. This has files and binaries that are required to run Spark on Hadoop using YARN. So that's it basically. This user provided Apache Hadoop. This is without Hadoop, you can see. And some other pre-built features for Scala. And this is the source code. So usually what is relevant to us is pre-built for Apache Hadoop 2.7 or later. Hadoop is currently available in 3.x. I don't remember the exact version. So it is for 2.7 and later. Let's see what else we have. This is to link with Spark. It is fine, but not very relevant. Release notes for all the stable releases. So that's it. Nothing much on the download page. Let's go to second tab, that is libraries. SQL and data frames. Let's see this. This page basically has some theory on data frames and how you can use normal SQL like queries into a Spark program. So they have defined some features like integration seamlessly mix SQL queries with Spark programs. As I told you, you can see these are the SQL queries, select star from people, but these are being performed on Spark objects. We'll go into it slowly in this series. Then other features, uniform data access. You can connect to different data sources like data from Hive or different compression formats, Avro, Parquet, some few small examples they have given. Hive integration. Okay, fine. We know it. Standard connectivity, JDBC, ODBC. We'll see this in further tutorial. And similar features, performance, scalability, just the theory. Fine. Let's see other things. Spark streaming. Okay. Spark is not only used for batch data. For new people, I'm telling, other people know. You can also process incoming streams of data in Spark. So this is a small theory regarding the streaming data. Ease of use, high level operations, fault tolerance, how as we are getting the stream of data, how Apache Spark handles that fault tolerance in case input data has some latency or some of the nodes that are fetching the data go down. So Spark streaming inbuilt provides us some fault tolerance algorithms that we will see later, and deployment options to different file systems like HDFS and messaging queues, Flume, Kafka, 0MQ. So all the small theory stuff, nothing very technical here. MLlib is the Spark library for machine learning. I don't want to go into that. It is a big and important library, but I don't think if we are learning Spark from level zero, we should be so quick to jump onto MLlib. So we'll keep MLlib and GraphX aside for now. Let's see what is third party projects. Even I'm not sure. So this is few packages that Apache and the open source community is building. Few are the ones that we have heard of, many are not. So not very relevant to learn Spark actually. Some of you have heard of Zeppelin and Delta Lake, Apache Mahout and stuff like that. So not very relevant. And when I say not very relevant, it is for this particular series. Don't take it otherwise, because we have to focus on real Spark APIs, that is RDDs, data frames. But anyways, we should not miss out anything on the documentation. At least we should be aware that these things are available. It also has additional language bindings. Language bindings in a sense that, as right now you know, Apache Spark programs can be written in Scala, Python, R, Java. So additional language bindings means if there is a language binding for any particular language, like here is C#.NET, use means using these programming language also now use Spark. Now next tab is documentation. It has latest release, older versions and other resources, and frequently asked questions. That's interesting actually. Spark documentation itself provides some frequently asked questions. Let's go through this. Maybe we'll find something interesting. With just a small skimming of this document only, I can tell we can have some very interesting topics in this FAQs that might be relevant in the interviews. So how does Spark relate to Apache Hadoop? You know, right? This is a very important interview question also. Let's say what they say. Spark is a fast and general processing engine compatible with Hadoop data. It can run in Hadoop cluster through YARN, as I just told you, or Spark standalone mode, as I discussed just now. And it can process data in HDFS, HBase, Cassandra, Hive, any Hadoop input format. So fine, good stuff to revise. Who is using Spark in production? Well, that's why we are here. But anyways, let's see. There are more than 1,000 organizations that are using Spark in production. Some of them are listed into this. Okay, fine. I don't want to go to that. How large a cluster can Spark scale to? See how interesting topics they have given in the documentation itself. Many organizations, this is a world level data, I believe. Many organizations run Spark on clusters of thousands of nodes. Seriously, I have never worked on 1,000 node cluster. The largest cluster we know has 8,000 of them, 8,000 nodes. In term of data size, Spark has been shown to work well up to petabytes. It has been used to sort 100 TB of data 3x faster than Hadoop. Interesting fact. Also 3x faster and 1/10 of the machines. So see, in these small points, you can get interesting information plus a point to note in our further series that, okay, this is working faster in comparison to Hadoop, and that too on 1/10 of machines. So we can have some discussion in our further videos that how was that thing applicable. Okay, I'll cover each and everything. Does my data need to fit into memory to use Spark? Very interesting and very important question for your interviews. We know, right? Spark does all the computes in memory. It is in-memory computation. So it's very fair to ask, does my data need to fit in memory? Suppose we have 500 GB of memory. We have that kind of memory in production clusters. Is it necessary that I can process the data only less than 500 GB? Does my data need to fit in memory? In two lines they have described, no. Spark operators spill the data to disk if it does not fit in memory, allowing you to run well on any size data. Likewise, cache data set that we do, very important concept, caching, that will be the part of optimization session in this series. Caching, where you cache some of your RDDs so that you can readily access it. Does that cached RDD need to fit in memory? So for that also they have told, no, that can also be spilled to disk or recomputed on the fly. RDDs can be recomputed, right? Again, this for this few points, only the people who have small idea of RDD computation and recomputation using DAG, they can understand. But for them also, the RDDs that you are caching that is not able to fit in memory, that can be spilled to disk or that can be recomputed. Good point, right? How can I run Spark on a cluster? So you can use either standalone deploy mode, we just discussed it, or Mesos, YARN, so it's fine. Do I need Hadoop to run Spark? We just discussed it. Does Spark require modified version of Scala or Python? Okay, I've never heard this question, but interesting. So basically they are saying that normal Scala language that we use as, I mean, normal programming language for Scala and Python, for coding in Spark, do we need to have some special version of those languages? So they say no. Even we expect that, like any generic language, if they are support, we can use it as it is. So Spark requires no change to Scala or compiler plugins. The Python API uses CPython implementation and can call into C libraries for Python such as NumPy. Okay, fine. Just on to that, I want to discuss a small topic that you might have faced in some interview. It's an important one. Is there some difference using Scala and Python for Spark? So yes, there is. Spark is actually a JVM based framework. So all the code that Spark has to execute runs on JVM. As if you are aware, Scala is a JVM language, Python is not, but still Spark has the API for Python. So again, I'm going a little bit ahead, but let's discuss this. When Spark program submits, it initiates a Spark context that submits the Spark code, whatever logic we have written. And that Spark context and entire further program has to run on JVM. So when we are using Scala, whatever Spark context and the executors that are running, we are submitting a JVM code itself. So JVM understands it and submits it efficiently. But in case of Python, Python program cannot run on JVM. So basically there is a socket connection between a Python program and the JVM, which actually converts that Python code into a Java code actually. So Python code will eventually convert into Java code, and that will be understood by the JVM, and the relevant code will be executed on the JVM. So just a small idea, maybe it will come further in some of the session. See, these are very good points in my opinion. It's very important. If you give few minutes and we'll have a discussion on this. I understand Spark streaming uses micro batching. Does this increase latency? So what this question means is, let me clear this. So it says Spark streaming uses micro batching. Very small explanation to what is micro batching. So this is basically related to streaming data. So suppose there is a stream. You can say we are getting the data message by message. Okay. And say these are message, sorry, I'll start from here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I won't say excuse me for my writing. That is a very boring comment everyone uses. I've seen many of them. They'll write something and just to make a small gag, they will say excuse me for writing. I'm not very good. So let's say this is a data stream. Okay. And what basically micro batching is, Spark uses this technique or algorithm, you can say, that divides, suppose there are millions of messages, that divides this in micro batches. Micro batches in a sense, a specific set of messages that they consider as one object of data, or in Spark this can be understood as a RDD. So they are asking, like, if it is using micro batches, does this create latency? So the answer they say is no, because they are expecting that this does not have an actual impact on any application, because this micro batches can be taken within the interval of as small time as half a second. And usually the data that many companies are analyzing or they are expecting is far more than half a second. So they are saying that most of the analytics are done in say 10 minutes, or taking some streaming examples like sensors data, they collected some 5 seconds, 10 seconds. So it is far slower than the capability of Spark streaming. Where can I find high resolution version of Spark logo? Okay, I don't want to see that. Okay, fine. Pretty interesting stuff. Then let's say as of today, what is the latest release? Currently we have Spark 2.4.4. So let's say what this page tells us. Spark is a fast general purpose cluster computing system. Okay, it's fine. I don't want to go. Security. Security in Spark is off by default. See, have you ever heard anyone talking about security in Spark? I mean, very rare, but yeah, we have that. Mostly security perspective is not much discussed or not much asked in the interviews, because you are mostly hired to process the data and efficiently process the data, performance optimization. The security is more of a admin level or infra level information that one should have, so not much. But if you want, you can go to this link and read about Spark security. Fine, here we have some documentation on downloading. You can download it. I'll see if in this session we will need to download Spark, or as in previous session I told you that I'll be using Cloudera Quick Start VM. So we already have all that. So not much relevant again. But anyways, if you want me to make some installation, Spark installation tutorial, let me know. And same documentation will be used and all information is here. Running examples and shell. Fine anyways, we'll be running Spark code. So nothing much. Master 2, okay, let's take a small discussion on this also. Master local 2, many of you know what this 2 means, what this local means. This means you have to run Spark on local machine using two of the cores. If you have star here, that is using all of the cores. So I'm just skimming through this, and whatever I feel important, I'm discussing. This is just an introduction to Spark and the documentation. Launching on a cluster, pretty important. Spark cluster mode overview, okay. Standalone deploy mode, Apache Mesos, Yarn, Kubernetes, API docs, Scala doc, Java API, all the API docs are here. But what is relevant in this for us is Yarn, because we are going to use Yarn to run Spark applications on Hadoop. Let's quickly see what is most relevant to us. This is security again. No, I don't want to go. So launching Spark on Yarn, that I have got many questions for this also. We want to run Spark jobs on Yarn, and that is mostly used in the big data industry, where they are using Hadoop cluster and using Spark on Hadoop with Yarn. So the same we will also follow in this session. Ensure Hadoop conf, Yarn conf is pointing to a directory which contains client side. Okay, fine. There are two deploy modes that can be used to launch Spark applications on Yarn. Cluster mode, very important. See, when you are using Spark on Hadoop using Yarn, still they have two modes, cluster mode and client mode. And I believe most of you will agree, this is also a very important question for interviews. What is cluster mode? What is Yarn mode? Because they ask like how you are using, which mode you are using. You will obviously say we are using it on Hadoop cluster. So you are using in Hadoop cluster on Yarn, that you say. Then which mode you are using? Cluster mode or client mode? Very important. Okay, before going ahead, let me quickly explain in very small point that what is cluster mode and what is client mode. So consider a Hadoop cluster with different machines. Okay, let's see. I have five machines. Okay, in this particular cluster, I should connect it. Okay. In a usual scenario, what we have is, suppose these are the five nodes of the Hadoop cluster. Now, we also have a node that connects to these particular nodes in a cluster. This particular node is used to connect as well as submit the Spark jobs to different nodes. This can be called as a gateway node, or you can call it as a edge node. This does not uses the resources of itself to perform any computation, but submits the code and processes the data onto different nodes. So let's suppose we are submitting a Spark code from this gateway node. Okay, as you know, we submit the code, let's say Spark submit on this particular node. Fine. What this Spark submit will do, this will create a Spark context, basically a driver program. And that driver program will make the workers execute on different data nodes. So driver program is running here, and that is making the executor code work on different nodes as per the resource availability. Very simply, this is the client mode. Why? Because the driver program is running on the node where you did the Spark submit. That's it. That is as simple as that. But is it optimal? No, obviously not, because driver program is the key. In case something happens to this particular node or any other program or any other application, in the sense any other user submits one more Spark code in client mode, again the driver program will run on this. The meaning of driver program running on this machine means this particular piece of code is using the resources of this machine, that is edge node. So do you think if 10 people, 100 people, depending upon the resources, all are submitting their piece of code which is using the resource of this particular machine, is it optimal? No, obviously not. But this concept is client mode. What happens in cluster mode? You submit a code from here, but the driver program itself will run on one of the node. And if everyone is going to submit in cluster mode, depending upon the resource availability, their respective driver programs might run on that driver program will also be distributed. Okay, so that is pretty much optimal. So that was client mode and cluster mode. Hope you got it. And how do you specify while doing Spark submit? First, the master yarn, obviously, and deploy mode is the parameter that is set to cluster or client. So see, small example also they have given, Spark submit. This is the actual Spark class that we have to execute. So if we are running on yarn, we have to specify master yarn. The two modes that we just discussed, that we can specify with the parameter hyphen hyphen deploy mode. Driver memory, how much memory that a driver program can take. Executor memory, executor cores. We'll come into these cores and memory when we are talking about the optimization. See, this is how we'll go just quickly. After this documentation, we'll start the Spark SQL for Scala, and where we'll mostly discuss on data frames, the most important topic. So we'll quickly jump onto data frames that most of you want. And after that, we'll come on to the optimization topics. So fine, this was all. Adding other jars if you have to add. We'll see once we start coding. Preparations, debugging. This is the important part. Actually, I wanted to show you, but currently what jobs they are running on that cluster, it will be not good for me to share that UI. But okay, anyways, once we'll run it, I'll show you the yarn UI actually. And yarn UI is very detailed, and we can basically see all the information, all the executor tasks, everything. I think a couple of session will take in yarn UI only. Just to give you an idea, whenever an application gets submitted to yarn, there is an application ID that is assigned to that particular Spark code. And in yarn UI that are visible in list, and it mentions like the job name, the start time, the status, is it running, finished, killed, failed, all that status. And if it is finished, what time it finished. And when you go to this application ID link, you can see different type of logs, what logs yarn generated, what logs your Spark job that got submitted to cluster that generated. So for debugging, we have to have a good understanding of yarn UI. I'll explain that along with when we run our Spark code on yarn. Then in parallel to that, I'll cover this debugging topic. So this was basically everything on running yarn, running Spark on yarn. So find more on this is configuration, monitoring, tuning guide. Okay, very important. Data serialization. Okay. The very important topic that I told we'll cover after after we finish data frames. So this is, I think, the second most asked question and request on my channel. Many of you have requested tuning Spark applications. So all this will come into that. Memory tuning, memory management. I told you, right? Each and everything will be given into this Spark documentation. So if we just follow this, we don't have to go anything anywhere out of that. And also see, I have limited time so I can give in making these videos. This is the best source, I have told you. I'll be discussing with you. Please watch my videos. It is kind of friendly studies, you can say, that I am also discussing with you that these are the things, this is how we do. But if you have more time that you can give into this, just follow this particular document. And if you also cannot give this much time, then just stick to this particular series where I'll be covering each and everything. I am not in a hurry. I want to cover everything in detail, but everything in detail. So that is my main motto. So fine guys, this was a small overview of Spark documentation. And let me know your comments and whatever my plan that I told, if you want some changes into that. And I'll keep posting this series daily. I'm planning. I do not want to miss any day in between. At least any information, any small practice also we can do. But I want to continue this daily. In a corner case, maybe 1 or 2 days get missed because of any particular reason, then that can be the exception. But my commitment to this is posting this session daily and having a proper communication with you in the comments. So if you liked the video, please hit the like button and please subscribe to my channel if you have not already done. Next video is coming soon. Thank you.